My father picks me up. He's quiet. He doesn't say anything. Then we go home and he turns. My father picks me up. He's quiet. He doesn't say anything. Then we go home, and he turns on the TV. We watch the Twin Towers fall. Afterwards, my father says,
"As a Muslim, things are going to change for you from now on. When you go to school tomorrow, prepare to have people target you. When you go to school tomorrow, some of your friends won't be your friends anymore. Don't be surprised if things change for you tomorrow."
Racism or classism, these are not things specific to white people. These are things specific to human beings. You know, human beings are imperfect, and that's something we all have to work against, our imperfections. But it's not just about white and black, it's about human beings. And that's important to look at in the big picture, that instead of being divisive, we should be thinking about how do we make the world a better place collectively. All of us.
Before a performance happens is like one of my favorite parts of a performance because everyone is so excited and there's this like buzz in the air because everyone is anticipating what's going to happen, and then afterwards I'm really excited because I can't wait to talk to my friends about it and ask them what they thought about it.
Thank you.
father picks me up. He's quiet. He doesn't say anything. Then we go home, and he turns on the TV. We watch the Twin Towers fall. Afterwards, my father says,
"As a Muslim, things are going to change for you from now on. When you go to school tomorrow, prepare to have people target you. When you go to school tomorrow, some of your friends won't be your friends anymore. Don't be surprised if things change for you tomorrow."
Racism or classism, these are not things specific to white people. These are things specific to human beings. You know, human beings are imperfect, and that's something we all have to work against, our imperfections. But it's not just about white and black, it's about human beings. And that's important to look at in the big picture, that instead of being divisive, we should be thinking about how do we make the world a better place collectively. All of us.
Before a performance happens is like one of my favorite parts of a performance because everyone is so excited and there's this like buzz in the air because everyone is anticipating what's going to happen, and then afterwards I'm really excited because I can't wait to talk to my friends about it and ask them what they thought about it.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening and welcome to this UMS presentation. We would like to thank the Digital Islamic Studies curriculum at the University of Michigan for their generous support of this evening's performance of Beyond Sacred, Voices of Muslim Identity. We would also like to thank the many other individuals, corporations, and foundations that have helped make this season possible. At this time, please take a moment to ensure that all personal electronic devices are turned completely off. We remind you that the unauthorized use of video, photographic, or audio recording equipment during this performance is also strictly prohibited. Thank you.
Let's get started.
بیایید شروع نمایید.
Please sit.
Assalamu alaikum. میرا نام ماہ سید ہے. میں 4 نومبر سال 1985 میں پیدا ہوئی. ماہ ایک قسم کی عرب ہرن ہے جس کی پہچان اس کی آنکھوں کی خوبصورتی ہے. میں تین بھائی بہنوں میں سے سب سے چھوٹی ہوں. Kadeem.
My name is Kadeem. On December 10th, 1991. I was born at Citrus Grove Hospital, the full head of hair. It was a mild winter. Amir?
My name is Amir Hossam Kafaji. I was born in Queens, New York on January 23rd, 1991. My middle name, Hossam, is my father's name. It is an Egyptian tradition for a father to give his name as the middle name to his children.
Tiffany?
My name is Tiffany Yasmin Abdul Ghani. I was born in Southside Hospital on May 26, 1988, in Brentwood, Long Island. My father cried tears of joy when I was born. Firdaus?
No, man, Firdaus Dehqanas. Man dar 15 saur sal 1374, saat 9 shab dar Kabul, Afghanistan, matavallid shudam. Fasl barani bud. Man haftumin farzand khanavadai khud hastam.
A short history of Muslims in America.
A pop quiz.
What did two captains of two of Columbus's ships to the New World, the Pinta and Inina, have in common?
They were brothers, and they were Muslims.
Who was Anthony Janssen van Salle, and what was his religion?
He was one of the largest landholders on Long Island in 1640, and he was a Muslim.
What was the name of a Muslim who fought under George Washington during the American Revolutionary War?
Bumper Muhammad.
What was the first country to recognize the United States after the American Revolutionary War?
Morocco, a Muslim nation.
What book did John Adams and Thomas Jefferson, the second and third president of the United States, both have in their libraries?
The Quran.
Who was protected in Thomas Jefferson's bill for establishing religious freedom?
Jews, Gentiles, Christians, Hindus, Mohammedan, and infidels of every denomination.
What percentage of the slave population in the U.S. was Muslim?
Between 15 and 30%.
What were the names of the highest-ranking Muslim officers during the Civil War?
Captain Moses Usman and Nicholas Said.
What was the one book saved from the University of Alabama's library before it was burned in the Civil War?
A rare copy of the Quran.
Where and when was the first documented mosque built in the United States?
Ross, North Dakota, in 1929.
What neighborhood in Manhattan covered the area from the Brooklyn Battery Tunnel to the World Trade Center from the late 1800s to the 1940s?
Little Syria!
But most of the Arab immigrants in Little Syria were Christian.
In 2015, which school system recognized the Muslim holidays of Eid al-Adha and Eid al-Fitr, becoming the first in a major U.S. city to do so?
New York City!
August 15th, 1947.
India gains its independence, but it comes with great violence. As the British withdraw from colonial rule, the country divides into two, predominantly Hindu India and Muslim Pakistan.
1 million people are killed in the ethnic violence that follows. 14 million Hindus, Sikhs, and Muslims are displaced. It is the largest mass migration in human history.
Farhat's family lives in the Indian state of Bihar. Her family is Muslim. Their neighbors are Hindu. Hindus are killing Muslims. Muslims are killing Hindus. It's neighbor against neighbor. Because Farhat's family has the largest house in town, the Muslim neighbors come to take shelter. There are 50 people crammed together in one house. The men take turns standing guard on the roof. They fire shots in the air to warn off potential attackers. One day, a Hindu neighbor comes to the door. He says,
"All these bullets are hurting my mango tree."
He's speaking in code. What he means is,
"We will not turn against you."
Eventually, Farhat migrates to Pakistan with her family. She will become my mother.
1949.
Trinidad. A young man named Donald wants to marry a young woman named Afroz. She comes from a strict Muslim family. They will not approve her marriage to a Christian. Donald converts to Islam and changes his name to Jamratman Ishmael Khan. They will become my grandparents.
1970.
The Bronx, New York.
Ishmael Khan and Afroz move to the Bronx with their daughter Florence. They are searching for a better life for their family. There are no mosques in their neighborhood. The family converts to Christianity. Florence will become my mother.
1971.
Kenneth Lamont Herring, like so many other African Americans in the 1960s and 70s, is inspired to become a Muslim by Malcolm X, the assassinated black civil rights leader. African American converts to Islam are reacting against Christianity, the religion of white supremacy, of those who denied African Americans their civil rights. Kenneth Lamont Herring will become my father.
1980.
New York City.
Shahid Hussein, an immigrant from Trinidad, meets Florence Shanhai, also from Trinidad. It is love at first sight. Shahid and Florence, Florence and Shahid. He will give up his Muslim faith to marry Florence, who is Christian. They will become my parents.
1983.
Hossein Mohamed Kafaji moves from Egypt to New York to work at his uncle's clothing stores in Harlem and Queens. Hossein thinks America will be like the movies.
Prosperous.
Equitable.
Just.
Safe.
The land of opportunity.
But it's the height of the crack epidemic. As a new immigrant in New York City in the 1980s, it is an eye-opening experience. He sees
crime,
inequality,
class discrimination,
racism.
1987.
Jackson Heights, Queens.
Hossam Kafaji's working his uncle's clothing store. A pretty girl works at Little Angels, the store next door. One day, he gathers all his courage and he says,
hello.
One,
two,
three, eternities pass.
The pretty girl smiles at him. Her name is Margaret. She's Puerto Rican. Hossam and Margaret. Margaret and Hossam. They don't know it yet, but they will become my parents.
1989.
Kuwait. I'm 4 years old and a tomboy. I like to hang out with the boys. My best friend is Mazen, and I beat him up all the time. My mom says,
Maha, that's what boys do. Girls don't do that.
When I want to play basketball, they want me to play tennis. When I want to play guitar, they want me to play piano. From an early age, I'm always the renegade.
1990.
Every summer, we visit my aunt on Long Island. This year, my dad stays behind in Kuwait for work. As the summer comes to a close and we're getting ready to go home, and then suddenly...
Iraq invades Kuwait.
Iraq invades Kuwait.
Iraq invades Kuwait.
August 2nd, 1990.
Iraq invades Kuwait.
Suddenly, we can't go home, and my dad can't get out of Kuwait. Iraqi officials want to nationalize Kuwait's oil industry. My father is a chemical engineer. His skills are needed so the Iraqis won't let him leave the country. We call him every single day. He always asks me,
Magul, do you still have the gap between your front teeth?
At night, I cry myself to sleep. I miss my father. I'm 5 years old.
1990.
My father is determined to escape to the United States. His friends risk everything to help him. They take him to the airport, hiding in the back seat between two women. Then they get to the checkpoint.
One.
Two.
Three. Eternities. Pass.
Everyone waves their ID cards at the guards and they get through. My dad gets on a plane. We are finally reunited.
1992.
Long Island.
The bedtime stories my mother tells me are hadith.
The stories of the Prophet.
If someone is walking down a road and sees a rock, they should remove it, lest someone trip on it. That would be a good deed.
This story will stay with me always. To me, that is Islam. It's about doing right by others and doing right by you.
1995.
My mother, Margaret, the Catholic Puerto Rican from the Bronx, who married Hossam Kafaji, the Muslim Egyptian, decides to convert to Islam when I am 4 years old.
Her mother is not happy.
Her sister says,
you're just doing this for your husband.
But my father never pressures my mother to convert. It's her choice. She'll become fluent in Arabic.
1995.
Long Island.
I'm 10 years old. When we visit my aunt on Long Island for the summer, the girls and women sit in the living room and we're taught religious lessons. The boys are outside playing basketball. I'd much rather be out there with them. My aunts will ask me,
have you prayed? Why are you wearing that outfit?
This never happens to my brother. My mom insists that as a daughter, I need to learn how to cook. I say,
Baya eats 7 times more than I do. He should learn how to cook.
1996.
Cape Coral, Florida.
We live in a small, conservative town. Our family is pretty much the only non-white family there. We don't really fit in. My childhood revolves around Sunday school and church picnics. At the picnics, it is all American food.
Hamburgers.
Hot dogs.
Barbecue.
But at home, we eat a lot of Trinidadian food.
Curried goat.
Roti. A flatbread.
China and aloo. Chickpeas and potatoes.
We listen to Trinidadian music and dance to our favorite song.
1 cent. 5 cents, 10 cents, dollar. 1 cent, 5 cents, 10 cents, dollar.
1996.
West Palm Beach, Florida.
I was supposed to go to Disney World, but I had the chicken pox and had to stay home. There is also a full-blown hurricane outside. Just as I'm going upstairs,
a parked truck comes crashing in through the front door.
This is my earliest memory. I'm 5 years old.
1996.
After 10 years of the Soviet-Afghan War and Civil War, the Taliban comes to power in Afghanistan.
They impose their own interpretation of Sharia law.
The set of laws that Muslim communities use to guide their daily lives.
Derived from the Quran and the teachings of the Prophet Muhammad.
Peace be upon him.
The Taliban's interpretation of Sharia includes
public executions,
amputation for acts of theft.
Men are required to grow beards at an approved length.
Women must wear the all-covering burqa.
Women are banned from laughing loudly.
Girls are banned from going to school.
Women are banned from playing sports.
Television is banned.
Music is banned.
Movies are banned.
Kite flying is banned.
The list goes on.
And on.
And on.
1996.
It is the day after the Taliban takes control of Kabul. My father works as a civil servant. When he and his co-workers arrive at their offices, they find
desks smashed,
cabinets destroyed,
chairs tossed everywhere.
The Taliban has already taken control of my father's workplace. He is out of a job, and so is my mother. She's a teacher, but under the Taliban, women cannot teach.
1997.
Jackson Heights, Queens.
I want to be like the kids on TV. I want to look like them. I want to talk like them. My cousins say,
Amir, anta lasso arabica fea.
Amir, you're not Arab enough.
Pero, tú no eres puertorriqueño de verdad.
Amir, you're not Puerto Rican enough.
What are you?
I internalize these voices of shame. I'm 6 years old.
1998.
My mom cooks all kinds of Egyptian food.
Kofta.
Ground beef baked on a stick.
Morhea.
A rich soup with grape leaves.
She cooks Puerto Rican food, too.
Fried plantains.
Rice and beans.
Chicken and stew.
But my siblings and I, we don't want any of that. We want
McDonald's.
1998.
Greenville, South Carolina.
My family moves from Florida to Greenville, a small conservative town. Everybody is white and Baptist, except for a very small minority. It's really boring. My mother is Baptist, but my father is Muslim. Every Sunday, I go to the masjid.
The mosque.
I go to the masjid for religious instruction. Our masjid serves half the state. Most of the kids are from Jordan or Pakistan, but there are some from Iraq, Indonesia, Morocco, and Egypt. I'm the only African American in the class, but everyone gets along. One day, my imam,
he is a spiritual teacher,
gives me a prayer mat he has brought back from Jordan.
This is the Muslim teaching of kindness.
1999.
Doha, Qatar.
We move frequently, and I have to start over at each new school. At the British schools, I'm teased because of my American accent. But when I transfer to an American school, I instantly have social status. Because South Asians in the Middle East are stereotyped as lower class, it's rare to see South Asian students as part of the popular crowd. But as an American, I can move between worlds. Years later, I will learn to question these hierarchies. But at 13, I just want to be popular.
1999.
New York City.
I'm 11 years old. My parents sent me to New York for the summer to stay with my aunts and cousins. New York is nothing like Florida. It's huge. There are people of all different colors and backgrounds. My aunt takes me to see
the Brooklyn Bridge,
the Statue of Liberty,
Times Square.
At the Virgin Record Store, I buy a CD.
Blondie.
I love New York.
1999.
Queens.
My dad opens a 99-cent store in Jackson Heights. Help him after school and on the weekends. It's a hangout for single Arab men.
Drinking coffee.
Telling jokes.
Listening to Arab music.
Around these men, I finally start to feel more connected to my Arab roots. I'm 8 years old.
2000.
Kabul, Afghanistan.
I'm really scared. I'm holding my mother's hand tight as we cross the street. We have to pass a Taliban station. What if they stop us? What if they hit my mother?
One.
Two.
Three. Eternities pass.
Nothing happens. They let us pass. This is my earliest memory. I am 4 years old.
2000.
Stockbridge, Georgia.
We moved from Florida to Georgia for my dad's work. I leave behind Krista, my best friend since kindergarten. Stockbridge feels like an all-white town. I don't really fit in. At school, there's a boy named Faisal. He's from Afghanistan. He keeps himself and studies hard. I notice him because it seems like he doesn't have any friends either.
2000.
Long Island.
We moved back to the United States. It's my first day of ninth grade. I get on the bus and everyone is staring at me. The girl I sit next to asks me where I moved from. When I tell her that I moved from overseas, she says,
"Wait, you lived on a boat?"
When the other kids learn that I moved from the Middle East, they say,
"Oh, did you ride camels?"
I'm shocked at how little people know about the wider world.
2000.
Kabul.
Under the Taliban, we cannot watch TV. We listen to the BBC to hear what's going on in the world. Under the Taliban, there is no telephone service. We can only write letters to our family in New York City.
2000. Georgia.
My dad's cousin Camille comes to visit from Trinidad. I haven't really met anyone from my dad's family before. I'm excited to meet her. When she arrives...
Surprise!
She's Muslim? She arrives wearing a hijab. I have never seen that before. I have never really met someone Muslim before, except for Faisal at school. I ask her why she wears the hijab.
I wear it to cover. It's my relationship with God.
Okay, but do you have to cover to have a relationship with God? Can't you just, you know, pray?
I need this because it symbolizes my modesty and my purity, like what I have with God, my relationship with God.
Camille stays with me in my room during her visit. She shows me how she prays, how she does the wudu, washing her hands and face to purify. I'm surprised when she tells me,
"You know, your father is Muslim too. He used to pray a lot. He used to go to the mosque."
2000.
One day we all go to the mall. This time Camille wears a niqab, covering everything but her eyes. Everyone is staring at us. My dad is embarrassed. I'm embarrassed and also confused. After Camille goes back to Trinidad, I ask my dad about being Muslim. He says,
"I don't do that anymore."
And we don't talk about it again. I won't meet another Muslim person for a long time.
Two thousand one.
September 11th, 2001.
Long Island.
It's a normal day. I get up, have breakfast, and get dressed. I put on a T-shirt, a funky silk screen of the World Trade Center, and head off to school. A short while later, the announcement comes over the intercom. A plane has flown in to Tower One. In the confusion and fear that follows, my friend says,
"Maha, your shirt."
I had totally forgotten I was wearing it. I go to my locker and put my gym shirt on. That night, there's a candlelight vigil on my street. My family doesn't usually participate in a lot of neighborhood activities. I tell my mom,
"Mom, we have to do this. We're the only Muslim family on the street. We have to show our loyalty."
The same day.
Greenville, South Carolina.
I'm in my classroom at Pelham Road Elementary. There is an announcement on the intercom.
"We have to close the school early. Something bad has just happened, and as a country, we need to be together. We're calling the parents now to come pick you up. Be safe. Be careful."
I'm waiting for my father.
One,
two,
three eternities pass.
My father picks me up. He's quiet. He doesn't say anything. Then we go home, and he turns on the TV. We watch the Twin Towers fall. Afterwards, my father says,
"As a Muslim, things are going to change for you from now on." When you go to school tomorrow, prepare to have people target you. When you go to school tomorrow, some of your friends won't be your friends anymore. Don't be surprised if things change for you tomorrow.
Later that day.
Later that day.
Later that day.
Later that day, our masjid is bombed. It hits the library and half the books are burned. Our masjid will be attacked again and again. No one is ever detained or charged. That's justice in America.
2001.
Stockbridge, Georgia.
Flags.
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 Every house in our street has an American flag. After 9/11, all of a sudden, everyone wants to know where I am from. No one asked me that before. To Faisal, the boy from Afghanistan, the kids say,
terrorist,
terrorist,
terrorist, go back to your country.
I have always felt American. I was born here, but now I feel like I have to act more American. I start going to football games, wearing American flag shirts. I decide to change the pronunciation of my last name. I say,
oh, it's not Hussein, it's Hosen.
I feel ashamed. I don't want to be associated with the people on the news. I just want to fit in.
2001.
After the Twin Towers fall, every project in school is a 9/11 project.
Write a letter to an American soldier at war against the infidels.
Draw a picture of a New York firefighter saving us from the evildoers.
Sing a song of patriotism for America.
2001.
Muslims are angry.
Muslims are evil.
Muslims are terrorists.
Muslims are being portrayed on TV and in the movies as crazy zealots who hate the United States. People around me watch the news and think they're experts on Islam. They watch
Fox News.
Sean Hannity.
Rush Limbaugh.
My dad calls into these shows and he tries to debate. He confuses me too. He says,
Osama bin Laden did it and these are all bad guys. America should go and get them. Making us look bad.
I don't want to be a Muslim anymore. I'm 10 years old.
2001.
Kabul, Afghanistan.
Gunfire.
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 Gunfire. U.S. and NATO forces attack the Taliban in response to 9/11. I hear gunfire near and far. It is not safe in Kabul. My mother says,
we are going to Kapisa.
We are going to my father's village. You're escaping from lawlessness, destruction, and sorrow.
2001.
The Taliban government collapses. Kabul is destroyed.
There are still suicide bombers.
There is still lawlessness.
There is still death and destruction.
There is still pain and sorrow.
اما زندگی می‌گذرد.
Yet, life goes on.
Life goes on.
Life always goes on.
And I can fly a kite again.
A night sky full of stars, secrets that will not come from the heavens to the earth thus far. He shot a star across the sky to hit the jinn in the eye.
There is truth everywhere you look, in the river's flow, behind the swaying tree limbs in the holy book. Allah bless our beautiful lives, from which we will return naked and in no disguise.
Allah saw you when you cried, like before you their tears surely dried. Now from the clay that we are made, we have life to praise Allah every day.
Five times is the prayer. More times, Allah will receive the glory. Faith is my passion. Conversion to Islam is my story. I was in a world of people, and there was one religion. One that I sought, where the word of the prophets had no revision.
It is plain to see with the humble heart. Allah loved you all and chose you from the start. You were a baby, a girl, a boy, a sister, a brother. He gave you a name, a wife, a husband, a child, a mother. He guided you with his might, opened the doors to Jannah as it rained, that you may be blessed and feel no sorrow, no pain.
He was stronger than any evil in the land.
because they could not touch all the good that Allah planned. There was nobody as good as our last prophet. If you have the truth, wouldn't you too offer it?
Stand high, ruku, kneel, and sujda, for there is nobody on this earth or hereafter that compares to you.
You are strong when I am in need. You are my friend when I break, bend, and bleed.
When nothing seems right, and all hope has gone astray, Allahu Akbar, in my mind, in my heart, and my tongue, your words will stay.
2002.
Greenville Middle School.
There are 1,000 students, and only 5 are Muslim. The name like Kadeem, you can hide even if you want to.
Towelhead!
The white kids hate me. I'm always getting into fights, always getting jumped. But it's worse for Faraz, who is Jordanian. Greenville Middle School never teaches tolerance or understanding of other cultures. It is a narrow-minded world I live in. I told my father, I want to go back to Florida. He says,
no, you don't. It's even worse there.
At my masjid, we discuss how we're being treated. My imam says,
put your best foot forward.
Don't give them an opportunity to judge you.
Show them that Muslim does not equal terrorist.
I think to myself,
what about the KKK?
What about the neo-Nazis?
What about gang crazy Americans shooting people?
An FBI study found that 94% of all terrorist attacks committed in the U.S. were committed by non-Muslims.
It's like it's our job to make people feel like we are safe Muslims.
Assimilated!
It's like we need to be the Oreos of Muslims. White people say to me,
oh, you're a nice Muslim. You make Muslims look like good people.
What the fuck do you mean we make Muslims look good? We're just people like anybody else.
2002.
My family moves back to Florida. I have to start over again. I go to Cape Coral High School.
Skater kids.
Nerds.
Football players.
Cheerleaders.
I don't fit in anywhere. I just want somewhere to belong. There's another group of kids that don't fit in anywhere.
The Misfits.
But they're really nice to me. I start hanging out with them, cutting class, smoking, hanging out behind the McDonald's. I start dressing like a goth punk. Pink hair, fishnet stockings, and short skirts. We're all kind of lost, but at least we're lost together.
2002.
I'm skipping school more and more. My grades are slipping. Krista, my one friend from before I moved, stops hanging out with me. She's a good girl, a good student, a star athlete. Her parents are worried that I'm a bad influence on her. Then one day...
One day.
My parents catch me cutting class. They say,
we don't like how you're acting. You need to start studying so you can go to college.
We are taking you out of Cape Coral High School. You're going to...
Cape Christian Academy!
2005.
Merry Christmas!
Every year, we call the Puerto Rican side of the family to wish them a Merry Christmas. My sister Zina says,
how come nobody calls us for Eid or Ramadan on our holidays?
My aunt Rina, whom I love, calls Arabs.
Hush up, pupil.
Sometimes my Catholic grandmother tries to make me break my fast during Ramadan. When my family repeats the ignorant things they hear in the media, I just want to say,
you're wrong. Your own family is Muslim. You should be the first to defend us.
But I can't. I just feel bad in the inside. I'm 14 years old.
2006.
At Cape Christian Academy in Florida, I spend 3 years studying the Bible and trying to lead a good Christian life. But I still don't fit in. I have so many questions. My parents want me to go to college, but I want to go to cosmetology school. I love doing hair and makeup. When I graduate, I am voted the student with
Best Christian Values.
2006.
I'm a lonely, confused, and angry teenager. Greenville is...
boring.
Bigoted.
Ignorant.
And stagnant.
My closest high school friend, Marina, who's half Japanese and half Italian, helps me get through it. We listen to hardcore and folk music together. We explore art fairs together. We both want to get out of Greenville. It is Marina who teaches me how to deal with ignorance. She says,
never confront ignorance with anger. You don't want to drop down to their level.
When will I escape Greenville? I'm 15 years old.
2006.
2006.
I'm an international relations major at the University of Chicago. I decide to study abroad in China. My parents are very concerned.
It's so far away. What will you do there by yourself?
We don't know anyone in China.
Why can't you just go to London?
My older brother is my biggest ally. He tells my parents.
This is important. This is for Maha's education.
I've always pushed the boundaries of what is acceptable for my family. My parents give me freedom in my choices, though they often disapprove. But education is the key. If I can make a case for education, I can usually win my dad over. My mom can't stay mad for long. I go to China.
2006.
I'm 15 years old. I convinced my parents to send me to visit my dad's family in Egypt. As soon as I step on the airplane, I feel like I'm already in Egypt. The flight attendants speak Arabic. They serve Arabic food. I'm so excited. Then, 11 hours later...
Welcome to Cairo!
Almost right away, I feel smothered by my father's family. I'm going to go sightseeing, but my older cousin just wants to sit home and watch TV. Some days, we don't even leave the house. One afternoon, I'm sitting in a McDonald's thinking...
I'm eating a Big Mac in Egypt. Why am I even here?
By the time I leave Egypt, I realize that I may be Arab in blood, but I'm not Egyptian. I don't belong.
2007.
Lahore, Pakistan.
I go to Pakistan for the summer to intern for a women's rights organization. I'm really excited, but I'm coming from an ivory tower perspective, all books and theory. On the ground, it's different. I see women coming from hundreds of miles away, desperate to escape abusive husbands and unable to get a divorce. It's devastating. It's easy to come charging in as a feminist and say,
this is unfair.
This has to change.
But change is hard. Because of repressive laws created in the name of religion, there's very little direct help the organization can offer. I leave Pakistan feeling emotionally destroyed.
2008.
Dix Hills, New York.
I'm a freshman at Five Towns College, a small private school. I have a six-hour commute from Queens every single day. All the on-campus kids are white and privileged. All the commuters are black. They don't have the money for on-campus housing, and neither do I. But I'm the only Arab around. Class differences stare me in the face.
2008.
Jackson Heights, Queens.
My father is struggling. The rent for his 99-cent store is just too high. He loses the store and starts driving a limo. He has a lot of high-end clients.
Jennifer Lopez.
Salma Hayek.
Tom Cruise.
Between going to a private college in a white suburb and watching my father serve the rich, my eyes are open to class, privilege, and inequality. We never see my dad anymore. And I miss him.
2008.
My favorite Pakistani tradition is weddings. Here's why.
One.
The mehendi.
Before the wedding, the bride is decorated with henna. There's singing and dancing.
There's a girl's side, and there's a boy's side.
There's a lot of trash talking and a sing-off.
The bride's sisters and cousins sneak up to the groom and grab his finger.
Then they refuse to let it go until he pays them off.
Two.
The groom arrives at the wedding hall in grand fashion.
The bride's brothers barricade the wedding hall entrance
so that the whole groom side has to wait outside
until the groom pays off the bride's brothers to get out of the way.
Three.
The nikah.
The religious part of the ceremony is sometimes held with the bride and groom in separate rooms so that they're veiled from each other until they're married.
The bride goes first and has to say she accepts the marriage three different times with two witnesses. Then the groom is asked.
Four.
The barat.
The bride's sister steals one of the groom's shoes and refuses to return it until a price is agreed upon.
I am the master negotiator at family weddings. At my cousin's wedding, we rake in $1,500. It is rowdy and fun, and there's just no topping it.
2008.
One night, my dad is waiting outside of a strip club with his limo for Redman, an associate of the Wu-Tang Clan, the hip-hop group.
Suddenly,
Redman and his friends come running out of the club and dive into my father's limo.
Gunshots pop!
2008.
Where's mom?
Where's mom?
Where's mom?
It's morning, and Mom's not home. Then she calls with the bad news.
Amir, I'm at the hospital with Dad. He was shot in the back.
The doctors tell us?
We can't remove the bullet. It's too close to his spine.
Your dad will survive, but he won't be able to work.
He's going to feel the bullet twisting in his body every day.
Yesterday, my father was the patriarch of his family, who made it to America, the land of opportunity. Now, he can't work. He can't support his family. We're evicted from our apartment. I'm 17 years old.
2009.
Gardner Webb University, North Carolina.
At Gardner Webb University, a Christian college, I see Christian students behaving in very unchristian ways. I have a Muslim Turkish roommate who is gay and drinks alcohol. I've always admired Muslims from the Middle East, but I learned they like people everywhere.
Complicated.
Contradictory.
I've been studying the Quran, the Bible, and the Torah, first to defend Islam and then to question it. Why is Islam the perfect faith? Why is any faith the perfect faith? None of them seem perfect to me. I'm in search of answers.
2009.
Chuck E. Cheese is where a kid can be a kid. Chuck E. Cheese is where a kid can be a kid.
I'm working at Chuck E. Cheese and going to college. Yeah. I have to help support my family. Since I'm not a waiter, I don't get any tips. I make $8.50 an hour. The worst part is, I have to put on the Chuck E. Cheese mouse costume for birthday parties. At least now I can pay for my own Metro card. But my grades start to fall. At the end of my second semester, I drop out of Five Towns College.
2010.
I join the Peace Corps. I'm sent to the Dominican Republic to work on women's empowerment and community economic development. During training, a friend asks,
do you think you're going to lie about being Muslim while you're here?
I've traveled all over the world, and it's never occurred to me to hide my Muslim identity. I tell him,
I've never done it to this point, and I don't need to start now.
2010.
Kabul.
My friend Samir Haq hasn't come to school for a few days. When he finally shows up, I ask him why. He says,
my uncle died. He's walking on the road at night when a NATO helicopter shot him dead. My uncle is not Taliban, so why did they kill him?
2010. December
17, 2010. Sidi Bouzid, Tunisia.
Police in Tunisia confiscate the streetcar of Mohamed Bouhazizi, a young fruit seller without a permit. He's the only breadwinner for his mother and six siblings.
Humiliated and frustrated, he stands before a government building and sets himself on fire. He dies. His death sparks a long simmering movement to erupt. The people rise up against inequality.
It's the beginning of the Arab Spring.
2011.
Bayside, Queens.
Revolution is sweeping across the Arab world. I'm glued to the TV with my dad. He's arguing every day with our family in Egypt. The Arab Spring is dividing my family along class lines. My father's happy and energized by the revolution. But my richer members of the family are afraid. I think to myself,
if it can happen in Egypt, it can happen anywhere.
2011.
Kabul.
I am on a bus. We are about 600 feet from my high school. An American military convoy is in front of us. When suddenly, there's a huge explosion. I'm in shock. A suicide bomber has struck the convoy.
2011.
Every time I go to school, my parents worry.
Firdaus, where are you? There's just been another explosion.
I don't feel free or safe here. Every day I go to school and then go directly home. Things are getting worse day by day. Then, good news comes. My mother tells me,
your uncle said they're starting the paperwork to bring us to America.
My grandmother and five of my uncles are there. I'm really excited. I'm going to
New York City.
Thank you. 2011.
September 17th, 2011.
New York City.
Banks got bailed out. We got sold out.
Banks got bailed out. We got sold out.
Show me what democracy looks like.
This is what democracy looks like.
All day, all week.
All day, all week.
Occupy Wall Street.
Occupy Wall Street.
I go down to Occupy Wall Street. The most engaging people I meet are people of color and low-income people. But I see a lot of middle-class white people controlling the show. I realize that even though this movement is billed as anti-hierarchy, there's still a hierarchical system here, too. I'm inspired to get involved in political and community organizing.
2011.
Long Island.
I'm working odd jobs at the mall, living with my parents. I want something more from life. One day, I go to the hair salon. I meet Aruna. Her mom owns the salon. She's about my age. She's wearing a hijab. I start asking her questions about Islam. Because I am curious, I ask her why she wears the hijab.
I wear it for God, because it's part of the religion and it's required of me. And I like it, too. It's very nice.
We talk about her family from Pakistan and what kind of food they eat. She tells me about her classes at Queens College and how she studies on weekends. Her life seems so different than mine, I think.
I wonder if my life could be more like that.
2012.
I'm ready to make a change in my life. I tell Aruna that I'm ready to convert to Islam. She takes me to meet her friends at Queens College Muslim Student Association. I tell the chaplain that I want to take my shahada, the testimony that you believe in Allah, to become Muslim. The moment I make the declaration, something is different. I know this is going to be a beautiful change for me. I'm at peace.
2012.
New York City.
The hurricane.
2 weeks after I return from the Dominican Republic, Hurricane Sandy sweeps across the city, leaving devastation in its wake.
2 million people without power.
23,000 businesses impacted.
$19 billion in damage.
Sandy reveals just how great the divide is between the rich and the poor. The have and have nots in New York.
Some of the worst hit areas in Brooklyn are in immigrant communities with few resources and almost no political voice.
I'm fluent in both Urdu and Spanish. I get a job at the Shorefront Y in Brighton Beach, advocating for immigrants, documented and undocumented, for their financial compensation after Sandy. You don't need to travel the world to find injustice and inequality. It's right here, in our own backyard.
2012.
Cannes, France.
I get a scholarship to study abroad. I leave my narrow world behind. I'm in search of answers. At first, it's tough. I don't speak French. I don't have any money, but my world goes bigger in Europe. I have Moroccan friends, French friends, Spanish, and Dutch friends. I meet a transgender person for the first time. Soon after I moved to France, Trayvon Martin, an unarmed black youth, is killed in Florida. My friends ask,
why is there so much hatred between cops and minorities in America?
Why do people assume that blacks are violent there?
I don't have answers for them.
2012.
When I tell my parents I've converted to Islam, they say,
we know you, Tiffany. You don't seem like you're going to be the best example of being Muslim.
I can learn. Eventually, my mom says,
if this is what you want, I will support you.
2012.
Greenville, South Carolina.
I'm home visiting my family. After dinner, we sit and watch TV. My father says,
you've changed a lot. Are you still practicing Islam?
I don't practice anymore.
When you're older, you might change your mind.
Since I was a child, I struggled to behave, to think, and to speak as a Muslim. I had trouble accepting the rigid gender roles ascribed to men and to women. I had trouble with the homophobia because I identify as queer. I had trouble believing in a God that must be he. And I have trouble believing in any God, Muslim, Christian, Jewish, or otherwise, that could allow slavery to exist, that could allow injustice to exist.
2013.
I've always been an easy-to-digest Muslim. I look and talk and dress and act like everyone else, whatever the hell that means. Some people look at me and say,
you're not as Muslim as someone who wears the hijab.
I don't understand how people can presume to define the faith and identity of other people and somehow put you on a scale, as if one's spirituality can be assigned some kind of a number. Today I'm a 3, but Ramadan's coming up, so I should really scale up to be an 8.
2013.
I decided to go back to school at LaGuardia Community College. I didn't wear the hijab when I first converted, but now I decide to wear it. It's not easy to learn to tie it. I have to watch YouTube videos. On the first day of classes, when they call my name,
Tiffany,
people are always surprised when I raise my hand to see that Tiffany is a girl who covers. One day, a boy tries to give me a Bible in class. I just say politely,
no thanks.
But inside, I'm thinking,
you know, I've read it already.
2013. Chuck E. Cheese is where a kid can be a kid. Chuck E. Cheese is where a kid can be a kid.
Chuck E. Cheese is a dead-end job. I want to finish my degree, so I register at LaGuardia Community College. It's not fair to my father if I don't. If I succeed, it'll make his sacrifices worthwhile. I got to make a living, but I don't like the system. So how do I negotiate?
2013. Done. North Carolina.
I'm visiting my grandma, Edna China. It's extremely country and done and a long way from France.
It is very isolated.
It's a barren old town that technology and progress bypass.
There is nothing but cotton and dirt fields.
This is where my father's roots are. To this day, railroad tracks divide the white part of town from the black part of town. The KKK marches through Dunn whenever it likes. The neo-Nazis have a headquarters there. Why don't people think of them as terrorists?
2013.
Kabul, Afghanistan.
Khuda hafiz.
Khuda hafiz.
Khuda hafiz.
Khuda hafiz.
Khuda hafiz.
May Allah be with you.
12 people come to Kabul airport to say goodbye. They are crying. My mother and sisters are all crying. We are leaving our homeland.
We're happy that you're going to a beautiful, powerful country.
We wish you a good life, a better life.
And then we get on the plane to a new world.
2013.
We arrive in New York City. My first American meal is
pizza.
In Kabul, we lived in a house with a stove for heat. We wash our clothes by hand. Now, in Elmhurst, Queens, we live in a building with heat and laundry in the basement. My neighbors are immigrants from everywhere. We thought when we got to America, all we would see are white people. Kujas san mardaman safed.
Where are the white people?
2014.
New York City.
After 2 years in France, the small-town boy comes to New York City. I get a job at O Cafe on 6th Avenue. The employees are mostly poor, mostly of color, and all from the Bronx. The people of color come into Manhattan to work for the white people. They can't afford to live here. There's a 17-year-old kid who spends $20 a day on lunch. He spends in 2 weeks what I earn in 2 weeks.
2014.
Chuck E. Cheese is where a kid can be a kid. Chuck E. Cheese is where a kid can be a kid.
I finally have enough money to get the hell out of Chuck E. Cheese. Tonight is my last night there, and there's a birthday party, and they're dancing that stupid mouse costume. One of the guests gets into a fight with the manager and throws birthday cake all over the fucking walls and on the floor. I gotta clean everything up. After 5.5 years here, I've only ever gotten a 50 cents raise. I'm done.
2014.
I'm studying at the new school. A student there says,
I'm not racist or anything. I just think Muslims take their religion too seriously.
What about the Christian right?
Yeah, but why is it okay for Muslims to treat women as second-class citizens?
You can say the same about middle-class America. Women still get paid less than men, and men still control women's bodies.
Well, why do women have to wear the hijab?
Where I grew up, near Bob Jones University, Baptist girls still wear skirts down to their ankles. Hasidic Jewish women here cover their hair too.
Why are Muslims so violent?
Why are Americans so violent?
2014.
I have a job at Key Food in Sunnyside. One of my coworkers asks me,
Where are you from?
I'm from Afghanistan.
Oh, the Taliban. Well, that's all right. I know a lot of Afghans. You're all good people.
Then I get a job in a clothing store in Jackson Heights. The owner asks,
Where are you from?
I'm from Afghanistan.
Oh, the Taliban. Afghans are all Taliban. They all support the Taliban.
I don't support the Taliban. They kill our people every day.
We're spending a lot of our tax money fighting terrorists there. It doesn't make any sense because they kill American troops.
They kill Afghan troops, too.
Days later, Firdaus is fired.
2014. Flatbush, Brooklyn.
I live in a Caribbean neighborhood in Brooklyn. For the first time, I encounter
Stop and frisk.
There are two cops who always harass me to enter my building. They ask,
What are you doing here?
I live here.
Let me see your ID.
They always have something to say to me. Being a Muslim isn't a problem here. Being black is.
2014.
People ask me,
What do you think about gender issues within Muslim culture?
And then I always have to break that down. I ask,
When you say Muslim culture, which one?
Being Muslim in Lebanon is not the same as being Muslim in Indonesia. And that is not the same as being Muslim in Sudan.
People talk about culture and Islam as if they're somehow separate from each other, as if one can be turned off while the other is examined. The strongest influences in my life are my culture, my religion, and my feminism. They inform and strengthen each other, and they make me who I am. We like to separate and categorize people into census boxes, but the human spirit is more complicated than that.
2014.
I'm proud to wear the hijab. I want people to know that I am Muslim and know that my story can be a Muslim story. Before I started wearing the hijab, if I went to the city, I would get a certain kind of harassment.
Nice legs.
Nice smile.
Arr!
Now I get a different kind of harassment. I take the Long Island Railroad and people just stare at me all the time. I imagine they are thinking that I'm going to blow up the train or something. One day, I'm talking to my mom on the phone in English, and an old white lady sees me, and she says,
You need to come off of your cell phone.
And I'm like, Why? And she's really rude.
You need to go back to your country.
I don't say anything, but I'm really mad inside. I don't want to retaliate and put a bad image out there for Muslims. I don't need to defend myself. I know I was born here. I'm proud of who I am.
2014.
LaGuardia Community College.
I meet Michael, an Italian-American, in my accounting class. He asks,
Where are you from?
I'm from Afghanistan.
Oh, I heard about the Taliban, but I don't know that much about Afghanistan.
Michael becomes my first American friend. We both have an interest in politics. Most American students are interested in fashion, pop culture, and iPads. They're generally not interested in politics, but it is important.
2014.
I am Sunni Muslim. My parents are practicing, my mother a lot, my father less so, and I'm in the middle. Being a good Muslim is to believe in peace, same as a good Christian who doesn't discriminate, who helps people in need. For Eid, the end of Ramadan, we go together with my uncles to a mosque in Flushing. This is the time to remember and help the poor.
To celebrate.
To visit with family.
To make special treats for friends.
To say,
Eid Mubarak.
Happy Eid to you. 2015. Terror attacks in Paris shock the world.
The mass media goes into overdrive.
Yet again, I'm exhausted by having to explain how the ideals of Islam are separate from the motives of radical extremists.
I'm heartbroken and uneasy. As tragic as the recent events in Paris are,
many, many lives were lost in Nigeria just a few days earlier.
And Beirut the day before.
Where's the media coverage on those tragedies?
The terror the French feel after the Paris attacks is the same terror Syrian refugees,
Nigerian refugees,
and Afghan refugees are trying to flee.
It has been 14 years since 9/11, and the political backlash against Muslims today makes it feel like history is just repeating itself.
2016. New York City.
I'm an ethnically Pakistani, Kuwaiti-born Muslim.
I have lived in 10 countries. I attended 16 schools in 20 years. I'm used to being seen as a minority, an outsider. But I've never felt like a minority in New York City, and that's probably why I feel like I belong here. New York will always be home.
I like how people of all backgrounds voice their opinions strongly here when they believe an injustice has been committed. Currently, I'm doing a lot of community organizing for people of color. Although I have left Islam, much of the culture of my faith is still important to me. I still don't eat pork. I still wake up before the sun rises. I still believe in kindness.
2016.
I am happy here, but sometimes I think,
why did we immigrate here?
It is hard for my father, who feels isolated here. He has lost his home, his career, and his country. I think to myself,
this is not a home for us.
But then I see the opportunities in this country, and the safety and security, and I say,
this is a home.
Eventually, I want to go to law school, but I have to get a job to support my family first. It is important. I'm interested in public interest law. I like to help people.
2016.
I'm still learning and changing. My family is really accepting of everything in my life, and they support my decisions. I'm not wearing the hijab all the time anymore. I still wear it to the mosque, and when I pray, this is the life that I want. Islam is making my life wonderful. It's flourishing. I'd like everyone to see me shine.
2016.
There was a time in my life when I wanted to whitewash myself, and I said,
I'm just an American, plain and simple. I'm going to fit in.
But no, I'm not just plain and simple. I'm richer than that. I'm an Arab Rican who will not hide his Islamic heritage. I got to stand up for my Islamic identity to show people that Islam is more than their ignorance.
2017.
Hard to believe, but it hasn't even been a month since Donald Trump was inaugurated as President of the United States.
But it feels like a lifetime ago.
I'm disheartened every time I turn on the TV or hear the news. The travel and refugee ban targeting Muslims makes me feel like people have forgotten. We are a country built on the backbone of immigrants. America stands for people having the right to practice their religion and be the person they want to be freely. That's what sets us apart from other countries, where self-expression and freedom may be limited. It's hard to envision a hopeful future with an egocentric president, and it's hard to say what will the next law be that prohibits the will of the people.
I'm so tired of having to constantly debate or prove my existence. It's not like people listen. I'm over it. This battle is for y'all now. I know that people of color will always have to fight, but we didn't choose that route. I feel like now the only option left for people of color is violence.
For me, Trump's victory, and now his administration, just reinforces what I have always known, that America is and has always been a racist country. Those who are outraged by the ban on Muslims stayed quiet for 8 years as Obama, our first black president, bombed more Muslim countries than Bush. Those who are outraged about Trump's deportation plan stayed silent as Obama deported more people than every previous president combined. If you are protesting today but stay silent before, you just have to ask yourself, how did we get here?
I'm not surprised that Trump is doing everything he said he would. I just thought it'd be a little harder for him. And I'm really proud of the people working to make it harder. As a longtime activist and community organizer, it gives me faith to see the widespread and sustained efforts of so many who never before thought it was important to be engaged. I hope this chapter in American history marks the beginning of solidarity between oppressed communities. This is what I'm seeing happen all around me, and this is the only way we move forward.
As a Muslim and recent immigrant, I feel more afraid than any time before. The Muslim ban shows that America is no longer the democratic and free country I believed in. The president's policies create chaos, conflict all across the country and the world. I believe that the protests and marches against the Trump administration should continue. That is the only strong weapon for people who think we are going in the wrong direction.
2017.
February 18th, 2017.
We rewrote the ending of this show in 2015.
After the San Bernardino shootings,
we rewrote it again.
After the election,
we rewrote it again
for tonight.
Our stories will continue to the next chapter.
We are writing our own history.
My name is Firdaus Dehkan. I was born on April 20th, 1996 at 9 p.m. in Kabul, Afghanistan, 6 months before the Taliban invade my city. My name, Firdaus, means paradise or heaven. It was the rainy season. Kadeen?
My name is Kadeen Herring. I was born in West Palm Beach, Florida on December 10th, 1991 in Citrus Grove Hospital. I'm the middle child, the black sheep of the family. My name means best friend or kindness, which is a pretty fitting name for me. It was winter. Amir?
My name is Amir Hossam Kafaji. I was born in Flushing Hospital in Queens, New York on January 23rd, 1991. A month later than my due date, I weighed 10 pounds, 5 ounces. My mother said I was a pain in the ass before and after I was born. I'm an Arab Rican from Jackson Heights, Queens. It was snowy. Tiffany?
My name is Tiffany Yasmin Abdelghani. I'd like to use my middle name, Yasmin, because it is my Muslim name. I was born on May 26, 1988, in Brentwood, Long Island. It was spring. Maha?
My name is Maha Sayed. I was born on November 4th, 1985 in Kuwait City, Kuwait. My brother picked my name out of his fifth grade yearbook, so I'm probably named after some girl he had a crush on. It was November, but it's always hot in Kuwait.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you again for joining us for this evening's performance. At this time, we invite you to stay for a Q&A with the cast of Beyond Sacred. To those sitting in the balcony in the rear of the auditorium, please feel free to move down to a seat closer to the stage. We will begin shortly.
Hi, everybody. We're going to be rejoined by the members of the cast. I'm Jim Leha. I'm the Director of Education and Community Engagement for UMS. Please come down and join us for a conversation. Come on out. Welcome back. Another round of applause for these guys. You've gotten to know the members of this cast. We're also joined tonight by Sarah Zatz, who is the Associate Director of Ping Chong and Company and another one of the creators of this work. And I want to just, we'll turn it out for your questions and responses in just a minute. But I'd love to just, since we have Sarah with us, ask you, what was the impulse for this production? And maybe tell us a little bit about the process of how it was created.
Sure. Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming out tonight and staying for the Q&A. And thank you to UMS for having us here tonight. So this project that you saw tonight, this performance, is part of an ongoing series of community-engaged interview-based theater works by Ping Chong and Company. And that series is known as the Undesirable Elements series. And we've had over 50 productions in this series since 1992 when it was originated by Ping Chong, our founder and artistic director. And those projects have been made in and with communities around the United States and have looked at a variety of issues from immigration to the experiences of refugees, people with disabilities. We've done projects with the Native American community, projects with transgender youth in New Orleans. So this project is another iteration in that series. And we were invited by our partner organization, LaGuardia Performing Arts Center in New York City, to create a project that specifically looked at the experiences of Muslim Americans in the United States, and in this case in New York City. And that was part of a larger initiative by the Doris Duke Foundation to create events. And I believe the University of Michigan and UMS were a part of this original grant cohort as well, to use university campuses and the arts to engage around issues of Muslim identity. So specifically looking at conversations about Muslim identity through the performing arts. And that was the original impetus for creating this project. And then in terms of the creation process, everyone here responded to a call for participants that we put out in New York City. And I think we had about 20 or so people come forward to be interviewed for the project. And then the five folks that were in the show tonight were the people that were selected. And in the end, we decided to focus specifically on young adults in New York, people who had come of age post 9/11.
So that's a great segue into a question for the cast tonight. Why was it important for you? Why did you become interested in this project when you learned about it? Why did you want to do it?
After you.
Oh yeah, I mean, I think for me anyway, it was just for the fact of having a very honest and a very diverse representation of what Islam can be. I mean, I'm African American myself, and I never seen an African American Muslim figure on TV or really anywhere. So just having the chance to be an actual individual who experienced what we all have experienced, and to have our own platforms and have our own scripts, like no filter, no nothing. It's the most raw, most honest portrayal of five very instances of Islam. Is for me was why I auditioned for it.
I guess I'll go. The more I do this show, the more important it becomes to me. The more I realize how important this show is. Why I do it and why I still do it is, you know, it comes to a point when you get sick and tired of seeing a Muslim who's on an airplane and he's about to blow it up rather than just going on a nice vacation, you know, and I got sick of that. Every time you look at, you turn on the news, we're the bad guy, you know, and that gets so tiring and you become to hate yourself. Growing up as a kid, and I talk about a little bit in the story, you know, I hated myself. I wanted to assimilate. I wanted to be like the kids on Full House, you know? That's the thing I had in my mind. That's the Americana that you're supposed to be. And being an Arab Puerto Rican, you know, you don't know where the hell you belong. And it was very complicated for me. So when I do this show, I think it gives the general public a sense that Islam is, it's not this one
thing. It's diverse. It's even more diverse than the group you see here today. And I think that's very important. And it's very important to tell your own stories. The more you continue to allow other people to tell your stories for you, to speak on behalf of you or for you or about you, you lose some sort of power. And this, to me, is a very empowering thing for us and for me personally, as well as the audience. Because as long as we have to tell our own stories, because as long as we don't, we're going to keep getting treated the way we are in the media. So this is my counter to Fox News and all the other stuff.
Yeah, I pretty much agree with what was said. And that was actually the same reason that I joined to this program as well. Muslim identity and also Muslim community have turned to be the scapegoat of Western societies, especially the American society, after the 9/11. You know, there was a time that communism was a threat, the Soviet Union and all that, but after 1991, and then after the Al-Qaeda bombings and everything, and after the 9/11 incident, then after all, that Islam became the new threat, or Muslims, all of them, became the new, enemy. So that's why I just wanted to, as a recent immigrant from Afghanistan, and as a Muslim, I just wanted to have give a different image from Muslims, to show that the majority of Muslims are moderates. They love peace. And Islam is, the ideals of Islam is not about, terrorism, about war, about violence. But, Muslims themselves are the largest victim of terrorism in the first place. So, that was the basic reason I joined this program.
Maha, Tiffany, did you want to respond to? Yeah, thank you. So one of the interesting things about how this piece is created is that you were all interviewed as individuals, and that you didn't really meet each other until you walked into the room to read the script for the first time. And then I know now that you've rewritten the show, the end of the show again. And so it made me wonder today as I was watching, were there any surprises by some of the things that you all were reflecting on, once you saw the new ending? Did anything that anybody said surprise you, or do you know what I mean? I'm very curious to know how you reacted to each other's new endings.
Tiffany with pink hair threw me off. I was like, what? Pink hair? Fishnet stockings? It was, whoa.
No. The new
hot stuff, right?
I mean,
I think I have to go now, we've been in this for like a year and a half with everyone here, so I know pretty well my crew, and it's not I was surprised. It's more of just, again, like I said earlier, like this is how we all feel. I mean, there's nothing altered about it. Like, you might not agree with what we're saying, you might not understand it, but I would hope you could at least relate to why each person feels the way they do. So I'm not gonna go that route and say who a person. I'm not doing that. But it was just really powerful and really made me go back in the script again and see, wow, this is why this person felt the way they did. This is why this person has this idea of what America or what terrorism or what their identity is being shaped by because of what they experienced. When Amir was leading to earlier about Tiffany and pink hair, I mean, as she was saying as well, we met each other the same way that y'all met us. By the script. So walking to a room, I had blonde hair at the time, I don't know when we did this, but walking to a room and hear about, Ferdows seeing suicide bombs and war like that, and it's blowed your mind. So
I think so. We, as we mentioned at the end of this, we've revised this a few different times in recent performances. And one part that was replaced by our reflections on the administration was that we initially had a reaction to the election. And I think what was surprising, because we don't see this until it's a finished product either, right? Like, we are asked to reflect on what recent, which is very difficult, to put into words how you feel at a given moment when the moment is the moment right now. Having to formulate your thoughts is very, very difficult. But I was really surprised after the election that Ferdows's approach was that this is the will of the American people. So this is how democracy works, and this is what we have to do. And my reaction was like, I don't have faith in people anymore, right? Like, I was just like, this is the most heartbreaking thing that's ever happened. And our new passage, it's almost like we flipped. Where Firdaus is like, this is terrible, there's an immigration ban that affects the country that he's from. And I'm like, I'm in protest every day. I live in New York City, I work in social justice, I have the privilege of being able to do this. And I'm seeing Black Lives Matter turn up for the Muslim ban. I'm seeing Muslims turn up for ICE raid bans. It's amazing, and it's the thing that we've been lacking for so long. So like, I think to yeah. I think to work in the field that I work, to work in social justice, the most important thing is that you have to believe in the goodness of people. And I had a crisis of conscience when Trump was elected because I was like, well, who am I working for? What am I doing, right? And now, like, I maybe it's me just trying to hang on to my career or what, but it's like, but like, there's like some sort of faith coming out of this where it's like, people are doing something about it, and people are starting to see the intersections of these systems of oppression. And it's like, if we all got together and did this together, like, we could change the way this works, right? And so, like, I really, really hope that that is, like, the shining light that comes out of so much pain and so many people's, like, lives being completely destroyed by our apathy. So, I mean, that's my glimmer of hope in this new passage.
I just want to add something from an artistic point of view. Like Kadeen said, you know, we've been doing this for a while. We have rewritten the passage several times. When we did the Santa Barbara presentation, it was 1 week after the election. And, you know, it was interesting. We'd already changed it, and we thought, okay, well, that passage might stand for a while. And then, you know, in the last 3 weeks, we've been like, oh, that feels really dated and hopeful. So I had, you know, I was the person that sort of reached out to each cast person and said, what are you thinking? What are you feeling? Please email me. I know this might be hard to kind of put down on paper right now. And I flew out to Santa Barbara and I wrote it on the plane. And then I flew out to Michigan and I wrote it on the plane. And the night that I got to Michigan, I spent the week in Dearborn. It was Tuesday night, and I emailed everyone, and then I texted them, and I said, you know, here's what we've got. Is this okay? Please let me know. And literally within 10 minutes, every person got back to me and was like, perfect. And, you know, the cast has sort of final say on the script, and Ping and I and Ryan are the co-writer, you know, we collate the material, but they always have the final say, and we've definitely nuanced and gone back and forth, and, you know, we've made changes. And in Santa Barbara, like, Kadeen and I went back and forth very carefully on some word choice, and, you know, this time it was just like, boom, done. And I think that also speaks to kind of how well we know each other, but also how confident everyone is in their own voice at this point.
I want to invite your questions and reflections. We have some microphones out there, Adam here and Sean there. Please wait for the microphone to come to you. I also just, in full disclosure, want to remind you that we are live streaming all of this right now. So if you don't want to appear on the internet, please don't ask a question.
Around after. Ask
yes,
us
you
the
can
question.
Ask a question afterwards. But wait until the live stream is over. We have a comment down here. Would you stand up and tell us your name?
Hi, I'm Hannah. My question was, well, since I'm not Muslim, but what is your favorite thing about being Muslim?
Huh. It was about
We have everything. Yeah. It's hard to pick one.
That's a really difficult question. My favorite part about being Muslim is being Muslim. Like, I really like it, and I really have a lot of faith, and it informs everything that I do, and it's really amazing to have the type of, like, sure guidance that I feel that comes from my faith that has repeatedly in my life pushed me in the direction of doing the right thing. And for working social justice, there's no reason I would not be here if I was not Muslim. I would not be working in human rights if I was not Muslim, right? And so to me, it's like absolutely everything because it's so intrinsically part of everything that I do.
The thing I like about being Muslim is a sense of community. We have our community that's close-knit together, and we go to pray together. We join in, like, the women join together and they pray in like this line. They like line up row by row and pray together, and it's just a sense of like home and like friendship and being close to people who care and want to help you within your community.
I'm a community organizer, and something I find that I value most within Islam is this idea of struggle that is unique amongst, I think, many other religions, is which Islam came out of adversity. And Islam has this strong sense of social justice and this sense of struggle, and through struggle there's growth. And I think that's very important. And I think in times like this where we have to struggle immensely, I think that's going to make us stronger as a people, and that's going to make us stronger as a country through that struggle. So I think Islam's emphasis on struggle really affects me in my daily life all the time.
Another question? Got down here. Would you stand up and tell us your name, please, if you're able?
Hi, I'm Steve. I assume most of the people who buy tickets are sympathetic to your message, and I'm curious what efforts, if any, you've made to expose the show to people who are less sympathetic. For example, I know UMS has school groups come in, and I'm guessing a lot of the students don't necessarily choose that activity. And perhaps you get some feedback from that type of audience that's different from the buying audience.
You all want me to take that one?
You want to go first?
So
I want to answer that.
I will say we get this question at every single performance we do. And I think it's getting stranger and stranger to answer. And the answer that I like to give is that, you know, when people say, aren't you just preaching to the converted? I say, well, you know, I think the converted or the choir, they may not be as converted as you think they are. You know, so it's really easy to think that you're in a liberal bubble in Ann Arbor. It's really easy to think that you're a liberal bubble in New York City, and it's not. I mean, we've had hate crimes in New York. I know there have been hate crimes on the University of Michigan campus, and so I think, you know, we may each individually think that we're in alignment with the message of this show, but I think the people around you may not be. And I think that right now the call to action is to take the next step beyond being sympathetic into being, and beyond being an ally and being someone who's really standing up and fighting. And whether that's making sure your campus is a sanctuary school or your local school system is a sanctuary school, people need to go beyond being sympathetic and to being advocates and activists. So that's my take on it. In terms of the specific question, we've taken this show to UNC Chapel Hill, where three Muslim students were murdered for being Muslim. We've done this show over 20 performances in New York City to high schools, and we had 700 high school students here yesterday, and I wasn't actually here for it, but a slightly fraught talk back at times. I think there are a lot of opportunities, even when you're in what might seem like a more progressive community, to both get the message out and hope that the audience members are taking this beyond an appreciative place of absorbing the stories into an action step.
If I can chime in for a moment. That question to me implies a sense of hierarchy already. It comes from a sense of superiority, that you're somehow better than the rest of the country, or you're somehow more enlightened than someone else, and that you knew everything coming in, and you're already, I'm already converted, I'm going to go in, I'm going to feel good about myself coming to see this program. And not you specifically, but that's the sense where that question comes from. And why would you come to see this show if you already knew everything, right? If you already knew everything about our lives. I guarantee you've never sat in a room where you heard five of us with completely different stories, five Muslim Americans from different backgrounds telling their story from their own mouths. That alone is enlightening. If you don't leave this room much more with a change of heart or a change of mind, or you change some sort of perception you had already, then we didn't do our job, but I think you would. This idea that areas that that liberals are usually a liberal white male always think, oh, I knew everything, I'm all in. That comes from a sense of privilege. That comes from a sense of superiority, and it's not necessarily true. If we keep thinking we live in our own little bubble, then, look, for example, Michigan was which is a union state, which is a state that was blue, voted for Trump. So what does that tell you, the failure of liberalism? This idea we know better. We don't. You got somebody like Bill Maher, who calls himself a liberal, who is fanatic Islamophobic, who had a Nazi on his show and gave him a platform last night of the alt-right as if he's an equal to everyone else, when he's not. So this idea that because he was attacking Islam, and they agree on that, So, like, this idea that liberals know everything, that's complete bullshit, and that's the reason why we're here now. Next question.
Well, not quite. I actually also, especially here in Michigan, I think it's really important, personally, and I've said this from the beginning to the whole cast, is to also talk to the Muslim community, is to have a display of the diversity of what Islam and Muslims look like in America for the Muslim community. Like, all of these things need to be examined inside and out, and there are issues within the Muslim community on racial diversity, on tolerance, just like every other religious or small community, right? And so for me, I mean, if you remember the passage of when I say people make judgments on how religious I am, I find it absurd, but those are Muslims that are doing it, right? And so to me, this is not just about, I don't know, I hate that term, but like educating people who've never met a Muslim or like whatever. It's about diversity and tolerance and like giving you a small sample of like what the human experience looks like, even if you all belong to the same faith, right? So to me, it's about everyone, right? Everyone needs to hear from everyone else. That's the point I keep belaboring.
Absolutely. All right, another question. Adam, over here. Tell us your name, please.
Hi. My name is Rick DeMent, and thank you. Hey, I have to say that I think these five stories are just incredible in their differentness, I guess, for lack of a better word. But I also get the feeling that you could have filled the stage with equally different stories from you know, in the same vein. What I'd like to ask the cast is, have you ever met some people, you know, another Muslim, where you went, "Wow, that's pretty different"? You know, I mean, can you help fill that out a little bit for me? Because I just thought that the differences in stories were really well done, and I bet you had a very difficult time picking them.
I saw a Muslim on a unicycle once, and I was like, "Damn, that's a difference."
Sarah, I was going to say, Sarah, maybe you want to say something about how, because surely you talk to a lot of people, and you selected these folks here.
We did. You know, this group has gelled so much, and we've done like 45 performances now. So it's sort of hard to imagine any other configuration of people in this group. We were specifically looking for a diversity of experiences, and we were specifically, it's not that we avoided people who came from Arab or Middle Eastern heritages, and we do have your story, but a lot of people, when they think Muslim, think Arab. And when they think Arab, they think Muslim. And so it was really important for us to try and highlight some different voices and perspectives. You know, Tiffany's family is from Trinidad. It was super important to represent the African American Muslim community, which is the largest Muslim community in the United States. And so we really wanted to make sure that that story and voice was represented. One thing that was unexpected was that we were originally intending it to be a more intergenerational show. And we found that as we did outreach, the vast majority of people who volunteered to be interviewed were people 30 and under. And when I spoke to my friends and people with community connections, a lot of people said, no one's going to come and talk to you, partly because, you know, it wasn't a culturally specific Muslim group making the project, and because people in New York and, you know, everywhere, and this is now almost 3 years ago that we started this project, and we were even in a very different time then, but you know, people are scared. People are under surveillance. The NYPD, the FBI have been infiltrating student groups, you know, and community groups since 9/11. And so people feel very at risk and afraid, and you know, speaking up and highlighting their community may not be what people feel comfortable doing. And so it was a sort of younger group of people who felt proud and confident and able to speak up. That doesn't mean that they may not feel at risk, but that it was just a thing that stood out to me in our selection process. And so that kind of narrowed, self-narrowed it down in a way. we are starting a project nearby in Dearborn with the Arab American National Museum that will be looking specifically at the Arab American Muslim community of Dearborn. And so that project will look very different to this one. And I think that's one of the things that we're trying to show is that, you know, there is no one Muslim identity, there is no one Muslim community, even, as Maha said, even within specific nationalities or communities who identify as Muslim.
Another, we've got one down here.
Hi, my name is Michelle. First of all, thank you. This was an amazing performance. So I am a theater artist and educator. And so my question is more about your histories as performers. Do you identify as actors or not? What does it mean to you to be performing your identity in this way? And also, just a staging question, how did you come to the conclusion to do it like a stage reading where you have the chairs and the music stands as opposed to a more artistically, quote-unquote, staged performance?
I can tackle the last part first and then let you all speak to your what it feels to perform for yourself. But the form that you see is the Undesirable Elements series form, which was created by Ping Chong in 1992 as a storytelling project. And the idea is that in order to work with non-professional performers who have maybe never spoken publicly, don't have a lot of performance experience, to have the script, to have the music stands, the microphones, allows people to feel confident in their performance. They don't have to memorize anything. That's one of the key things that we tell people who want to come forward. And then the artistry comes through the, you know, the theatrical elements that are included, the projections, the lighting, the score, and the voices, you know, and Ping calls it a seated opera for the spoken words. So although they do change seats and there's a little bit of movement, the real movement comes from you kind of pinging back and forth, listening to the listening to the voices go back and forth. And that's where the kind of theatrical movement comes in. And every show that we've done in this series looks like this. They're all told chronologically. They all have this kind of intro section, which we call like a name game or a historical section. They have you know, individual poems or other sections. We don't really do it in the show, but there's something we usually call the what do you think of section, where people answer that question, like what do you think of when you hear the word, whatever the theme of the show may be. So that part is kind of a set form, and it allows us as an organization to have a replicable model that we can bring to different communities and quickly adapt to the issues and the themes of whatever the community partner that we're working with wants us to explore. So that's the sort of structural part of it. So that was born with Ping's artistry back in 1992, and we've sort of expanded and elaborated since then. And then I'll turn it to the cast to speak about performing themselves.
Yeah, I mean, I think I'm an actor, like, why not? I get paid.
They're all professional actors now.
I get, like, free water and, like, snacks. So I definitely think I'm a performer for sure. Yeah, definitely.
Okay, we're not actors, but these are our real lives. Everything you know about us, you do actually know about us. But I mean, yeah, in this regard, like, it's because I'm also not an actor. I actually really love the arts for social change, but have never been able to be an actor because I could never memorize lines. So this forum is so incredibly perfect for me to be able to engage in an art form that I really love. But I mean, to go a little bit on a tangent, and please stop me, but it actually feels like we're performing characters at this point, right? Like, 45 performances in, like, these are memorized lines. We are doing certain facial expressions. We are enunciating certain words that we wouldn't do on a normal day. And so it does start to be a little more distance. And that's when the part of, like, adding new sections gets really challenging, because all of a sudden it gets raw again, because there are feelings you're feeling right now. You're not talking about 1985 anymore. But yeah, so I had a background, I mean, I do a lot of public speaking for my work. I used to sing when I was really, really little, but I don't think that counts. But I've never acted outside of this performance.
Amir, you're looking for an agent, right?
For what?
You're looking for an agent, right?
If anyone's here, come talk to me. I think I was born ready to be on the stage, tell you the truth. I'm loving this, okay?
All right, how about another question? This side first, okay.
Hi there. My question is that
I'm wondering if it is a concern at all to you, especially this young lady who is interested in this concept of social justice. Aren't you concerned that by pursuing this anti-concept of social justice, you're actually undermining the genuine path toward individual rights and individual justice, which once formed a path for immigrants to make progress in this country? Because throughout history and philosophy, the concept of justice is always and exclusively one of individual justice, by which each person receives their due. But by substituting this false concept of social justice, you're undermining the foundation of individual rights, which is the right as a human being to be the subject of your own life and to remain unmolested by political powers. But by substituting the social justice concept, which wants to impose government-imposed objectives and end results on individual people by violating their individual right to be unmolested, you're actually bringing immigrants into a self-destructive form of almost self-immolation, because they will never no longer connect their right as a human being to be unmolested by individuals.
I have a feeling the cast has a lot to say about this idea.
But let me just add, philosophy, social justice does not have an existence.
Yeah.
Let's give a chance for these guys to respond.
I think I have a pretty good command of the English language, and I just don't understand what the hell you're trying to say. I don't know what history you're talking about. I don't know, the civil rights movement was not a movement by an individual, it was a movement by the people, okay? So this idea that an individual and you're undermining social justice, you're wrong, okay?
So I think I have a little bit better of an idea of what you're trying to say. And I don't think you and I agree on what we call individual rights or social justice, and that's fine, and we can continue this offline. But we all enjoy the protections of living in a society where you forfeit some of your individual rights, right? That if you're talking about philosophy, that is the social contract. Okay, but so I'll stick around after the show and we can go into this a little more.
You're not capable of understanding what we're trying to say.
All right. Well, I don't know if you're into this for the discussion, so I'm not going to answer.
I think that we have, real differences of opinion and philosophy that are not necessarily going to be resolved in the context of this format. So I would invite you to stay after and have some more.
As do I.
Have some more dialogue. maybe one more question. Yeah, over here. We'll bring you the microphone.
Hats off to you guys for a wonderful performance. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
My name is Adisa. I'm an instructor here at the School of Social Work. And as I was listening to the very personal presentations, I thought about how my students are so fearful about public speaking. And even if you set aside your faith tradition, considering you all have lives, how do you do this? Like, how do you sit before these folks, much less stand and sort of bear yourselves and your story? And do you encounter fear, and how do you manage that in the context of these presentations?
I remember the first time when we when I went to the Chong+Company office and I was discussing my story. They were asking me different questions and stuff, and I felt very overwhelmed, because I was tracing back all these memories of things that happened to me in like high school and things that happened to me when I was a kid, and then I got to see like my growth and stepping stones throughout the stories that I was telling them, and it made me feel very emotional, and it made me feel like I wanted to cry, because sometimes things were really hard for me growing up. As like I was a teenager, like I didn't fit in anywhere, I didn't have many friends, I just always wanted to be part of like a crowd with somebody where I could feel like I felt like a sense of home and a relationship where I would be close to somebody who would like be like a sense of community and care for me. And I feel like I found I found the community that I want to be in, and I found the place where I fit and the place that I feel like is home for me, and that's being a Muslim. And I think conquering the fear took a lot of steps and a lot of growth and a lot of opportunity, and it took a lot of strength on my part and my cast members' parts for them to find where they belong in life too.
Well, we're coming to a close.
Kadeen.
Yeah, go ahead. Sorry.
That's fine. I think for me, just for myself, it's actually been harder to keep doing the performance. Not that it's not enjoyable, but it just kind of wanes on you a little bit of like, wow, this is like, it's kind of like a therapy session. Like every time I do it, it's like, well, this is why I was so angry. This is why I was so outrage or misinformed or so much anger. For me personally, as a kid, it's just like, wow, I'm looking at it on paper and I'm still here. But when I look back on it, friends that I knew back home, it brings a lot of memories, as Tiffany was saying, like you start thinking of what you were experiencing as a kid and how that has affected you to this point now. And now what's going on with, you know, the elections and the political climate, and also, you know, I was in France, and I have friends in Syria, and, you know, just a lot of other things are happening. It's like, wow, I'm still in this production, but, like, is it getting people that I thought it would get? I thought in the beginning it would be, oh, I'll do performance, I'll feel good afterwards, and people go outside and, you know, just organize things. But it was like, no, that's not how things work out. So it's kind of like I do it because I feel like I do it kind of for me. It's like I need to realize who I am, what I am, and how I can continue.
Well, for public speaking, I think it's important to emphasize the importance of public speaking, but yet it's one of the most common fears people have, right? So how I conquer my fear of coming out and talking to 1,000 people or hundreds of people or whatever is the fact that I'm doing something most people are afraid of doing. So even if I screw up, I'm conquering this fear that most people would be terrified to do. They would be shaking and sweating and stuff. So for me, that gives me a lot of comfort, you know. even if I screw up, I'm here, you know. But also this idea that you're not worth anything, that what you say is not of value. And I think that's that holds people back. But what you do, especially if you come from black and brown communities, oppressed communities, what you have to say is so important and needs to be heard. And everything you have to say, well, some things, everything you have to say is of value. And you should never be afraid to speak your mind. So,
thanks, Mir. So, I just want to thank all of these guys up here on stage. I've just gotten to know you a little bit over the last, you know, 2 days, and I feel so grateful for your generosity and also your courage in sharing your stories with us this week. And thanks to all of you for being here to listen. And have a great night, and we'll look forward to seeing you here again.
Thank you.